do not need a material donation.
We do not need a material donation.
O Lord, you are the master of the entire universe. What have you not given to us? You have entered the core of our hearts and dissipated the darkness of our ignorance by your effulgence. This is the supreme gift. We do not need a material donation. O Lord, you are the supreme personality of God, who have accepted the Brahmanas as your worshipable deity. Your knowledge and memory are never disturbed by anxiety. You are the chief of all famous persons within this world, and your lotus feet are worshipped by sages who are beyond the jurisdiction of punishment. O Lord Ramachandra, let us offer our respectful obeisances unto you. Purport by Srila Prabhupada, 2, text 6. When Dhruva Maharaj was offered a benediction by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he replied, O my Lord, I am fully satisfied. I do not need any material benediction. Similarly, when Prahlad Maharaj was offered a benediction by Lord Narsingadeva, he also refused to accept it and instead declared that the devotee should not be like a vanik, a mercantile man, who gives something in exchange for some profit. One who becomes a devotee for some material profit is not a pure devotee. Brahmanas are always enlightened by the Supreme Personality of Godhead within the heart. Sarvasya chaham hridi samivishto. Matasmriti jnanam apohanam cha.
Matasmriti jnanam apohanam cha.
And because the Brahmanas and Vaishnavas are always directed by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, they are not greedy for material wealth. What is absolutely necessary, they possess. But they do not want an expanded kingdom. An example of this was given by Vamanadeva. Acting as a brahmachari, Lord Vamanadeva wanted only 3 paces of land. Aspiring to possess more and more for personal sense gratification is simply ignorance. And this ignorance is conspicuous by its absence from the heart of a Brahmana or a Vaishnava. So this ends the Bhaktivedanta Swami translation for text 6-7, report for text 6 of chapter 11, canto 9, Srimad Bhagavatam, Mahapuranam, in the matter of Lord Ramachandra rules the world. So here the Brahmanas have revealed what they got from Lord Ramachandra. He entered the core of their hearts and dissipated the darkness of their ignorance. How many would like that? Hari-o. This is the special mercy of the Lord. Krishna Surya Sama Mayahoy Andakar Jaha Krishna Taha Maya Nahi Adhikar. Krishna is like the sun, and Maya, the material illusion, is like the darkness. Wherever there is Krishna, there is no more nations, no more darkness. Sometimes people say they want to get rid of their ignorance first, then they'll practice Krishna consciousness. But actually, Krishna consciousness and bringing Krishna in the heart is the solution to the darkness. Turning on the light takes away the darkness. Someone makes other arrangements that won't be as effective as simply turning on the light. So Krishna, he enters into the heart of his pure devotee and he dissipates all the ignorance. So this is what these great brahmanas, vaishnavas, who were performing the yajna for Lord Rama, they were feeling. Therefore, they gave back the kingdom to Rama to manage as a kshatriya. And they expressed that actually him having removed their ignorance was the supreme gift. To give transcendental knowledge, that is supreme gift. So also we want to give people the supreme gift. Why give them a lesser thing when we can give them the supreme gift? So Prabhupada was explaining how some groups are busy, actually the impersonal groups who believe that Absolute Truth is not a person. Simply they're believing in the impersonal effulgence of the light. They, because the impersonal truth is very boring, not variegated, so they're not able to sustain so much interest in meditating on the impersonal truth. So that's what Prabhupada said many times, you see that they revert to mundane social activities. Now, this is highly appreciated by the public. Because the public doesn't know what is a supreme gift. They think that, well, if we get some tangible material aid, a house, an education, some clothing, some food, this is great. So this they can appreciate. They may not appreciate like these brahmanas did, until they actually get purified. What is the wonderful nature of the supreme gift? Because they're conditioned like that. So the Prabhupada mentioned that we need at least one organization that's giving out the supreme gift. One organization that's giving people Krishna consciousness. There are already so many in the name of serving Krishna, they're giving mundane material blessings. But they're not giving actually Krishna. The real point is that we want to develop our attention to Krishna. That happens when we chant. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Sri Gauravrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. When we chant the holy names and we get the mercy of the Lord's presence, because the holy name of Krishna and Krishna is not different. There are other many other mantras. But that means, okay, so the mantras which are directly focused on Vishnu and Krishna. These mantras have got more potency because they're transcendental. The 10 offenses to the holy name, which are mentioned in the Puranas, also explain that if somebody thinks chanting then that also creates some contamination, some offense. If we think that the names of any of the other, of the non-Vishnu deities, even Shiva or Durga, or just speak of others, are equal or independent of the name of Krishna, then that becomes an offensive thing. We don't want to just merge everything together. There's some differentiation. That's why it's very important that we chant the names of Hare Krishna. Not to chant names which are not Vishnu names. Of course we can pray to the demigods or goddesses as devotees and ask them for blessings. For devotion for Krishna, something like that is all right. The gopis worshipped Katyayani in order to get Krishna as a husband. So if our object of worship is to get Krishna, then it's all right. But if somebody is worshipping some deva or devi in order to get some material benefit, thinking that they're independent, totally then that becomes an obstacle. Similarly, if somebody worships Krishna for something material, then they can get that. But it reduces their worship to something of a business propagation. I worship you, giving you what you want. You give me what I want, which isn't what you want from me. So someone worshipping Krishna and asking for Krishna bhakti, that's not mercantile, because that's what Krishna also wants for us. But Krishna can give us a material blessing very easily, that's not the problem. He can give that very easily. Most people are worshipping God with that type of prayer. We have whole groups of people that pray for each other's health and everything. But we also, sometimes the devotee also may pray for another devotee's health. We always qualify if it so please you. As for a devotee's health, so the devotee can go on with his or her devotional service. Things have to be somehow connected to Krishna, to make one with Krishna's desire. If it's not according to his desire, okay, then drop it. So examples are given here of Prahlad Maharaj. She was offered by Nrisimhadeva anything he wanted. And then he felt like, you know, I'm born in a family of demons who are very materialistic by nature. So don't tempt me. But Prahlad, he didn't accept any material benediction. There was this secretary of Ramanujacharya, had been blinded by an enraged, fanatical Shiva worshipper, a king who was a Shiva Bhakta, that he didn't like it that this secretary was saying that Vishnu was supreme. So he blinded him. So then, what's his name?
Kuresha.
And he couldn't really do that service as a secretary, being blind. So he stayed at the Bharadraj temple in Kanchipuram, in Tamil Nadu, India. The temple is very ancient temple, thousands and thousands of years old. It's still there. You can go and see that deity. And Kuresha was singing bhajans and kirtans and songs for the praise of this deity. Deity became very pleased and offered Kuresha anything he wanted. So he prayed to please forgive the people that did this to me, because I don't want them to suffer on my account. We continued chanting. Sometimes again the deity was please and offer another blessing. Again he asked for something like that for the welfare of others. And so happened that Kuresha, he went to see Ramanujacharya. And then Ramanujacharya said, I heard the deity is offering you anything you want. If he happens to offer you anything you want again, please tell the deity that your Guru Maharaj has some property which is not, which is kind of broken. It's malfunctioning. It's incomplete. And as a result, it's not so useful in his service. So the Guru would like that this property would be restored to its full functionality. Something like that. So that would be the only kind of prayer that Kuresha would add, something, but not for himself, something for the Guru. So then he went back and he was singing again by chance to the deity. Again the deity offered him. So then he asked for that prayer that the Guru asked. Immediately he regained his eyes. Because Ramanuja's mind was my servant, my secretary is like this without any eyes, who can't do the service. That was Ramanuja's intention, that he would regain his servant, his kind of a property, but regain the full functionality. So then he would return back to Ramanuja and take up his service again. Like you see, the pure devotees, they don't want to ask anything material for themselves. That's their nature. There was this lady in Mayapur, she was going blind. But she just prayed to Lord Narsingadeva that I'm going blind, so it's maybe the last darshan that I have of you. She didn't ask for anything. And then the Lord Narsingadeva came in a dream and told her that, see, if you give back my original eyes, I'll give you back your eyesight. Somebody, originally Lord Narsingadeva had red eyes, and somebody gave him new eyes, really fancy, with a green stone. Green eyes. Apparently Narsingadeva didn't like green eyes because he's in a very ferocious mood. He wants red eyes. So when the lady told this to the pujaris, they did a big ceremony and they replaced the eyes of the original eyes of Lord Narsingadeva. And then as subsequently the lady regained her eyesight. And Nrsimha Chaturdasi, they're telling us so many different pastimes of this Nrsimha Devi. Some seems he's very active. Some Vaishnavi was also bringing a basket of mangoes from Nrsimhadev, and at the last minute she got some doubt that Nrsimhadev probably doesn't like mangoes, he's not so good or something. She didn't give them. That night Nrsimhadev came in a dream and said, "Why are you giving my mangoes? I like mangoes." Next day she came to the pujaris and told what happened, so please, give the mangoes. At Mayapurdam also there's of course the pastime of Polavetra Sridhar, who was, Lord Chaitanya used to really give him a hard time. As a child, as a boy, he used to go and get his vegetables and bananas and similar such products from him. He'd always underpay him, argue with him, very naughty. Sometimes he would accuse him that you're overcharging me. And Kolar says, "I'm not overcharging. You can check the market and give you the lowest price in the entire market." And Lord says, "No, you're overcharging me." And then he'd grab a bunch of bananas and he'd throw him half the price and take this. And Kolar just said, "Grab the bananas back. What are you doing? I'm not giving you, I'm not charging you too much." The Lord said, "What do you think I'm doing? I'm steal your bananas or something? I'm calling a Brahmin a thief?" This is very offensive. Threw another coin and then walked off. I've been hated as people say, "Why are you taking it from this guy? Why are you, Kolavetra Sridhar, why are you taking it from that naughty Nimai?" So, well, I don't know. Whenever I see him, my heart just melts. Actually, even if he took the bananas for free, I wouldn't care, but he seems to like this. And later on, when Nimai Pandit became the big professor, he didn't go to the market anymore to argue with Polavetra Sridhar. But he'd go and visit Polavetra Sridhar at his house. And so he said, "Oh, how's it going, Kolavetra Sridhar?" "Well, everything's all right. Please set my pranams." So somehow the conversation came where Lord Chaitanya said that, "Well, I know that you actually are a very rich person and you have a hidden treasure. But I'm not going to reveal it now. Okay, you can keep your treasure hidden, it's all right. But I know that you're actually very rich. You have a hidden treasure, and one day I'll reveal it to everybody. But from now, just give me some of your fruits and vegetable products." And what are you going to eat? So somewhere before he asks, what are you doing now? How's your worship for the Ganges going on? And then he says, "Oh, I'm doing whatever I earn, I give half to the Ganges and I worship." He said, "Well, you know that I'm the father of the Ganges." "Are you Vishnu, Vishnu? How you can say such a thing? That's Vishnu." He thought, "Actually, I thought when I grew up they got less naughty. You still, you know, such a thing. How you can say such a thing? It's very mischievous." My Lord, she said, "Hey, give me some bananas." But listen, normal people begging, they get the worst I want the best. Worshiping my Shaligram Shila, you need the best. You give me the best stuff you got. Don't just give me some, you know, refuse. I was giving my heart. Every time I drop by and see how he's doing. In the name of just visiting an old friend, and he's giving him this minor mercy. So when I was Lord Chaitanya's Mahaprakash pastime, when Advaita Acharya is offering the 21-hour arti, then he sent his devotee and said, go get Kolavriksha Sridhar. When they went to get him, then they told him that Lord Chaitanya, that Gauranga, Gaurahari wants to see you. He was, wants to see me, just a banana seller. He fainted, it was like too much. He's very, very humble. So then, what to do? They picked him up and carried him to Lord Chaitanya. One grabbed his two legs, somebody grabbed the arm and carried him. Plopped him down in front of Lord Chaitanya and that big arti. When Kolavriksha Sridhar came to consciousness and he saw the effulgent form of Lord Chaitanya. This was not the Lord Chaitanya you normally see, who kind of put this illusion over his appearance, that he appeared just almost like somebody in the material world. Now, all that covering was off. And he was emitting so much effulgence that was more brilliant than millions of suns. As a result, the whole world seemed to have disappeared. All you could see was Lord Chaitanya and his associates. Nityananda was, was fanning with the shamar, and Shivas was holding an umbrella. Arti was going on, and the devotees were chanting in kirtan. Some days we have long kirtans for an hour, hour and a half. It's unimaginable, a 21-hour kirtan. In the presence of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, revealing his identity to all his devotees. So, Kolavriksha Sridhar saw the Lord, he paid his obeisances, and the Lord offered him that, okay, I'm going to give you a blessing. So normally Lord Chaitanya is in the mood of a devotee. But in a couple of occasions he reverted to his original Krishna consciousness. His mood as Lord Krishna. And so as the Supreme Lord, he would give the Supreme Lord one of his functions to give blessings. One of Krishna's names is Varada. Vara means blessings, and da means to give. Varada. Varada Krishna. So Varada Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he was offering Kolavriksha Sridhar, I'll give you whatever you want. He asked him, what do you want? What blessing do you want? Kolavriksha Sridhar, I'm just to be able to see you like this. This is such a blessing. I don't want anything else. Thank you very much. I don't need anything. I'm so happy just to have your darshan. Unexpected, unlimited blessing. The Lord Chaitanya, he said, no, I want to give you something. Okay, then I asked him, you want to be a king? I'll give you a kingdom. Right. How many here would like to be a king, have a nice kingdom? Queen, and good people. Right, the colonists just sit there and eat rice. They don't know rice anymore. I'm the king. So. I want to give you something. You can't go empty handed from Krishna. So, let me give you mystical powers. You can become smaller than the smallest, bigger than the biggest, anima, nagima, prapti, anything you want, you can have it in the material world. So many people are anxious to get these eight cities. So you can have it. No, no, which I don't want to say it's serious, it's not something I need. Whatever I have enough, I don't need all these things. Then, what you tell me to offer, okay, let me give you impersonal realization, Brahma Jyoti Marji. No, 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 I don't want that. Please, don't give me that. But what you want, you have to take something. But finally, after a lot of insistence, I told her, I said, well, if I have to ask for something, I'd like to always see that beautiful, smiling face of that naughty Brahmin boy. And I'd like to, at all your incarnations, I'd like to provide you with your fruit and vegetable needs. Give me this service. And this very simple person. Like to this is what this one you wanted to do. So Lord Chaitanya was and said, but if I'm not qualified for that, all he didn't say, he was so humble. If I'm not qualified for that, at least let me be born in a family of your devotees. So that I can continue on with my devotional service. Then Lord Chaitanya, he said, I'm going to give you something so wonderful. Brahma and Shiva are anxious for this. I mean, this is the supreme blessing I have. I bless you with pure love of Krishna. Hari! All the devotees in Kirtan, they were like, explore it. Here the little, the flea market, banana salesman, Kolavetra Sridhar. That's probably the most like, equivalent thing we have here. If you've been to India, you see these village markets where all the people sit down with their baskets. Offering their wares, you know. Kola patak, kola patak. Garuche, garuche. So he was like, bananas, bananas. Very simple guy. But hidden behind that simplicity and that poverty was this hidden treasure, that he was a pure devotee of Krishna. And Krishna recognized him. The manner that he wasn't, you know, the high class guy, didn't need a palanquin or Rolls Royce or anything. His treasure was he was a pure devotee. That's why Krishna always kept going to see him and buying from him. Even someone who is very poor, they can also be a pure devotee. There's no like a financial cutoff that you have to make this much to be a pure devotee. Anybody can be a pure devotee. An example, because Kolavetra Sridhar, he was really the like the poorest of the poor. On top of that, he was spending 50% of his income. So Lord Chaitanya, when he said, I'm giving love of Krishna, the devotees were just overwhelmed. They're pulling their hair, they're like, Hari Bol, Hari Bol! They're rolling in the ground.
I was like, this is a fantastic. Kalama Chasudaga, love of Krishna. God bless you. So, we can see this way, he refused any material benediction. He didn't want any material benediction. He was thinking that all throughout the histories of great devotees, when they're offered some blessing, they don't take some thing that's not connected to Krishna service. Always want to continue unlimited service to Krishna. That's their particular quality. So these brahmanas here, they're obviously very great devotees, pure devotees. They don't want material benediction. They're feeling so much blessed that the Lord has entered into their hearts. This is really what we need. The Lord should enter into our hearts. That's why we wear a tilak and 12 parts of our mind make our body into a temple. We chant Hare Krishna trying to purify our heart to welcome Krishna's siddha. Once he comes, of course, they become totally purified. But at least we don't want to invite him to sit down and eat some total garbage. So we're hoping that Krishna will come and be present in our hearts. Illuminate our heart from all the darkness of ignorance. Nitai Gauranga Bole Nachaya Marmon. Nitai Gauranga Bole Nachaya Marmon. Nachaya Marmon. Nachaya Marmon. Nitai Gauranga Bole Nachaya Marmon. When we chant Nitai Gauranga, they're dancing in our minds. Nitai Gauranga, Nitai Gauranga,
Nitai Gauranga,
Nitai Gauranga, Nitai Gauranga,
Nitai Gauranga, Nitai Gauranga.
They're dancing in our minds, they're dancing, so that purifies our consciousness. And we want that Krishna come and stay in our hearts. That's the devotees are ever anxious for that. The Lord revealed himself in their heart. Somehow, these brahmanas, they got that. They felt that they had that blessing that the Lord actually entered into their hearts. Supreme Lord is the worshipable by everyone, especially the great sages who know who should be worshipped. They worship the Lord. But the Lord, he accepts the Brahmanas and Vaishnavas as his worshipable deity. Krishna is respecting the Brahmanas in his pastime, so that's why. We also hold the Brahmanas very dear. Now it's very hard to find that's a special quality. Let's see who else was there. But how Krishna is so wonderful, actually. That's smile and then although he is worshipped by everybody, he worships his devotees. He worships the Brahmins. I thought there's some verse, I forget where it is in the Bhagavatam, that explains how if you take a human being and you calculate, and just for comparing the universe, where the human being stands, use them as a comparison, integer one. Like sometimes they say, what was the Australian dollar worth in 1970, what's it worth today? And they compare how much buying power and so on and so forth, type of study, so something. They say how well the Gandharvas are 10 times was the ghosts first, and then the actions and the Gandharvas and him and all those. The whole, like one after another, the Chinnayas, all the different levels in the universe. Each one was 10 times more than the previous one, and the next one, next one, next one. He got up to the Asuras. Powerful, mystical demons who, due to their austerities and penances, they become very powerful. But 10 times more powerful than them is the Devas, the demigods. And then 10 times, 100 times more than them is Indra, is the king of the demigods. And 1,000 times more than Indra was Brahma, as the creator of the universe. But it's what to speak with the Brahmanas. They're even respected by Krishna. The Brahmanas and Vaishnavas are even respected by Krishna. Who can, who's unlimitedly more powerful than everybody? They would say, how powerful are the Brahmanas? And even some Brahmana cursed Yamaraj to become a Sudra. He came down as Vidura. So, the human being were really insignificant in the universe. I remember once I walked with Srila Prabhupada on the roof of the lotus building, and there was a migration of all kinds of ants were leaving one hole in the wall and marching to another hole in the other wall. And there were thousands of them carrying these little white ant eggs. You could see the big mother, what we call the queen ants, and the worker ants, and everybody marching along, entering into some other drain someplace. So we're looking down at them. The Prabhupada, he just commented, it's like we're looking down thinking, what insignificant creatures. How they just live for a few days. They're very insignificant, you know, we're so great. But actually, the residents of higher planets, they look down at human beings with their cities and their highways and their tollways and everything. They look down and they're buzzing around and they just think, you know, how insignificant, they only live for a few days. Because one of our years is one of their days. So if we live 100 years, that means it's 100 days by the calculations of the Devas. That's like 3 months. Like what kind of animal lives 3 months? Some mouse or something, I don't know, something probably really insignificant, I don't know, a cockroach or something. Maybe even a cockroach lives longer than that, I don't know. But anybody, any biologists can remember what lives for 3 months?
Some butterflies live 3 months.
Yeah, so we're kind of like on the level of a butterfly.
Turning into a worm or something, a little caterpillar. Very insignificant. But if a human being becomes a pure devotee, if a human being becomes a Brahmin, amongst the Brahmanas, the best of the Brahmanas, is a pure devotee of Krishna. Then you leapfrog over and all, and you become suddenly a very universally important personality. You see, but what? Normally, people who only are born in Brahminical families, they kind of get the samskaras to become Brahmanas. In history, a few people like Vishwamitra was born in a Kshatriya family, who could become like great tapasya, became Brahmana. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy, people can become Brahmanas fairly easily by becoming Vaishnavas, because being a Vaishnava automatically qualifies one as a Brahmana. Mr. Krishna, he's also respecting the Brahmanas. That's how important the Brahmanas are. The human being doesn't understand that they're an eternal spirit soul if they're just on the bodily platform. They're really, they're very insignificant. Sometimes they're like living dead, just, you know, living to die. But the Brahmanas are living to go back to Godhead. The Vaishnavas. So we're trying to create these Brahmana Vaishnavas. And one of the qualities that we have the potential to have those 50 qualities, whether we have them or not. Brahma has them, but whether we have them, mercy, charity, all these different qualities, potentially there in a living entity. Whether we're manifesting them or not, to what extent we have them developed. Some living entity like Brahma was a fully developed jiva, has them, all 50. But for some, not as much as Krishna does. And then Shiva has 5 more than Brahma. And Vishnu has 5 more than Shiva. And Krishna is the only one with all the 64.
Do we get to be the potential of 50?
Right. Pardon?
At the moment, we just covered by ignorance.
Yeah, I mean, those qualities, it's said different people may be manifested to different degrees. Brahma has more manifested than Indra normally, right? But some pure devotee may have many of those 50 qualities are highly developed. By Krishna's mercy, the Brahmanas have these qualities. Because they have wonderful qualities, that's why Krishna respects them. It's not just, you know, like being a Brahmin or something like a title or a caste. It's actually like being twice born and being spiritually awakened, and they also awaken many of these wonderful good qualities. But we went out yesterday, Sama Damas Tapaso Cham Shantir Arjuna Mahivacha Jnanam Vijnanam Astikyam Brahma Karma Vivarajam. Peacefulness, self-control, austerity, purity, tolerance, honesty, wisdom, knowledge, and religiousness. These are the qualities by which the Brahmanas work. So these qualities, there's something very appreciated even by Krishna. You can expand on that more, those 12 qualities in the Bhagavad Gita, you can make 50, 26 of our sadhana.
increase in their good qualities, we try to avoid the bad things and enhance it further. That comes automatically by the chanting and by the process of our devotional service. If you see good quality in somebody, then you can appreciate that. Try to see the good qualities in others and try to find out the defects in ourselves and eradicate our defects and emulate the good now. Is that alright? Yes, Smriti Ananda Priya?
I'm talking about myself. I have this temple. So we have this idea that everyone should be pleased or feel considered myself, myself nice, and be happy with me. And then I have this also some qualities where I'm sort of arrogant and I might displease the people. And when they sort of criticize, it's very hard to hear if someone is sort of displeased with me. How should we correct this?
Well, that's kind of paradoxical, what you're saying. On one hand, I have these bad qualities and I'm ignorant and arrogant and proud. So I just deal with somebody, then when they tell me about it, I feel good. But maybe it's good not to feel good. Yeah, about those qualities. Maybe that's like part of the medicine, is that sometimes you need someone to tell us, sometimes maybe a friend really. But hey, come on, you know, the priest. How come you're feeling like that? Rather, we should be so much introspective that we see it in ourselves first. I mean, we already got a hint that this is our tendency, that we should go out of our way to be more humble and more, and avoid arrogance. And Vaishnavas, in case they do something even halfway good, then they always think that anything I could do good was by the mercy of the deities, mercy of my guru, blessing of the Vaishnavas. They don't like to take the credit for themselves. They take minimal credit for themselves, maximum for the all the mercy of Guru, Krishna, and so on. So arrogance usually means that somehow we're taking the credit ourselves, and we're forgetting that our ability to do anything well. It's also the blessings. Something like that, we're trying to. And the Tridhata Peace, Sunichanata, Ravibha, Sahishana, Madhina, Madhina, Kirtaniya, Sadhani. So we should wear that around our neck, over our heart, constantly. To be more humble than a blade of grass, more tolerant than a tree. To offer all respect unto others, but not to expect any respect for ourselves. It seems like you are expecting some respect. You didn't get it. You're not supposed to expect it. It's rather supposed to give other people appreciation. Appreciate other people, then you'll find you probably get less criticisms too. But when we think that I'm doing pretty good, everybody should appreciate how well I did. And when they don't, then we feel frustrated. Well, that's exactly what this verse tells us to avoid. Rather, we should be thinking how I can appreciate other people. For me, it's okay. I'm just going to go on trying to do the best I can. Really, and also, it's also very difficult to please everybody. You're trying to please Guru and Krishna. But sometimes you get indication of other Vaishnavas are not pleased, and maybe Krishna's not pleased either by something we're doing. So this again, that's what we need to be sometimes introspective. Like there was a time when that Brahmachari got the sauce from Lord Chaitanya. The Brahmachari, who was the kind of a yogi Brahmachari, came and was peeping Tom, looking at the Harinam, and then Lord Chaitanya asked him, you know, what you doing, and then evaluated his self-realization standard and figured out that he was really not up to the mark. Told him so. Told him that he wasn't ready to be in this confidential kirtan. And they showed him the door, but afterwards he was thinking about it. I said, really what Lord Chaitanya said, it was correct. I'm really not that spiritually oriented. I'm putting a big show on. Actually, the people who were chanting and dancing in kirtan and chanting Hare Krishna, they were so much absorbed in that chanting, they were not faking it. They were really there, they were really where it was at. And then he was just starting to become very humble and thinking that, how did I get the mercy even to see Lord Chaitanya's kirtan, see those wonderful devotees? He started crying. The Lord Chaitanya sent for him, brought him back in, said, you know, you're ready. So sometimes we may have to hear, you know, a little bit of correction. You know, then, of course, it comes especially from someone who's more senior than that, someone who's more responsible, and it's more appropriate. I mean, easier to digest. But that's... And that's part of the whole experience, that we sometimes have to get some advice, how to improve. We should actually ask for it. Where people, you know, we should actually be eager to get that, but if we don't ask for it, then eventually, you know, get on somebody's nerves enough, they just might volunteer it. Whether we like it or not, then, you know, that's kind of upsetting. If somebody gives advice in a more tactful way, then probably you wouldn't feel that upset, you would get more out of it, so we could all probably learn that. And rather than just kind of blurting out what you don't like about somebody, you could tell people what you do like about them, and then advise them what you think they could improve at. And then maybe they can, most of all, they should digest that a lot easier. Materialist, I mean, like Hiranya Kashyap, you couldn't digest any kind of suggestion from Prahlad, however nice it was presented. I hope you don't have too many Hiranya Kashyap words around here. Another question? Sarada? Sarada?
So often we have our own ideas and plans for our lives, and I get all confused, and I play games with my own mind. How do we just let go of those games and surrender?
Interesting. We all make plans. Plans are part of life. We'll have goals. It's good to always verify with our goals, if our plans are Krishna conscious enough, if they're appropriate enough. As a man proposed, God disposed. We're proposing something about Krishna. If our plan is acceptable, Krishna's plan for us, and it may work out. If he has completely another plan, it may not. So at least we'd like to know that whatever our plan is, seems to have a semblance of acceptability. And through prayer, through discussion with spiritual master and different things, we We try, sometimes we have one plan, it doesn't work out. We go back to the drawing board. We always, at least, whatever our plan may be, that it fits in with, it's harmonious with our being Krishna conscious, then we'd be pretty safe. And Srinivasacharya had his plan that we wanted, there's always different things happen, didn't exactly work out, but eventually, because he always kept to the same Krishna conscious ideals, and eventually got properly situated. We can't give up, right? But we should also verify the principle what we want. It's all right. And then after that, we try for it, and sometimes on the way, if we maybe find out something that works out even better, it's hard to know sometimes in the beginning, but if we didn't try for the one thing, we would have never got to the point where we could find the other thing. So it's hard sometimes to know. Things get revealed. I never could figure out what should be my career, because I always like to do certain things, and then I thought, let me try Krishna consciousness, and then somehow whatever the ideas I had, I'd like to do, it seems like I got more than I could even bargain for. Prabhupada gave me so much service and so much opportunities. So I feel it worked out for me all right, but there was, like I told about a grihastha, migrated to Canada, but he couldn't find a decent job in Canada. Then somehow I got a job with a Canadian company to work in South Africa. And now he's, in South Africa, but then there he's able to use his experience in Bhakti Riksha preaching and setting up many Bhakti Rikshas in South Africa. Sometimes you're bounced around, you don't know exactly how. I was made the president of Calcutta, and then next thing I know, Prabhupada sent me to Mayapur, and I was the president of Mayapur. The devotees, they learn to be a little bit flexible, play things as they come along, but always to keep their spiritual principles as their guiding principle. Initially, it's good to have a plan that's feasible, Krishna conscious. Mahatma Das, wow, I have a flood of questions today.
You know, in the course of lecture you said that Krishna is already in the heart of everyone. So he has to come again. So I can understand this. Can you expand on this?
Well, Paramatma, of course, is in our heart, but if we want to bring Krishna in the heart, in a more direct way, the Krishna coming in our heart in a direct way that we can also experience. And that's what illuminates our heart. I said, when we chant, Dita Gauranga Bole Natsriyama Ramon, then Krishna's dancing in our mind. So probably explain, just like in the temple here, we don't wear our shoes, we don't let people bring in dirty things. We don't smoke in here, we don't drink, we don't, so many things you don't do in a temple. Now, we want Krishna to come into our heart and be present there in a very visible in a way that we can experience His presence. So we want to keep out some of at least the gross garbage that's in our heart. So So we don't want to bring in intoxication, we don't want to bring in, you want to bring meat into a temple, so we're bringing meat into the temple, we want to bring in meat. That's why we try to be vegetarian and try to avoid taking intoxication and gambling and things like that, so that we can have our pure heart within which to invite Krishna when he comes. And then you do the initial, this gross, you know, get the gross dirt out of the house, and then after that Krishna illuminates everything and it becomes evident. But it's not that Krishna is manifest in everybody's heart in that perceived manner. He's there as super soul, but sometimes they're not even aware of his presence at all. We're talking about bringing Krishna there, as we can hear that we can get directly instruction from Krishna, we can perceive his presence, we can sense a transformation in our consciousness. Any last question? Keshav Prabhu.
One of the Purushottam aspects.
Yes? I
wonder if you can tell us on the qualities.
Alright, well. It's the favorite month of Krishna. It's even more than Damodar. The months of the year, the normal months, Damodar is the favorite, but then Purushottam is like Krishna's month, Purushottama, Supreme Personality of Godhead. And services and charity and spiritual activities done in that month are very, very powerful. I can't remember the numerical equation, I'll look it up and tell you, but it's mentioned in Padma Purana, but it's very, very powerful. The Ekadasis in that month are also super powerful. So it's a very good month for people to, if they're, of course devotees are already at max speed the whole time, then they're going to get all the benefit for all the months, but if there's some one hasn't been working at the maximum, optimal level yet. At least that month is a good time to rev up your motors and go at full speed. If you're not chanting 16 rounds, then that month try to chant. It's a good month to invite Vaishnavas to your house and to do service for the deities. Probably good for congregational preaching, these kind of months are really good to get everybody fired up, like everybody be a vegetarian or Purushottam month if they're not already. Get them to chant a certain number of rounds if they're not already, or increase it. It's a good month to get them to plant some donations, because they get multiple benefits and do some, bring some bhoga in every day, visit the temple. There's different things you can do. I can post it on the website, well, all the things that you can do for a Purushottam month, but this comes once in 3 years. I remember reading about it 3 years ago. I should have read up before I left, because I'm just kind of numbering in a general sense. I don't remember all the details. But there's also some pastime about it. Purushottam month is like for materialists, they don't think it's like not a good, you know, it's not, they don't consider it a good month. But actually for spiritual life, it's really good. That was the last question, Steve. Make an exception for you?
Yes.
Vasanadini says yes. You got an advocate here. I just don't want to see, we have to break our Ekadasi fast. What time is it, 10:15? 10:40. Okay, we've got a little time. We're going to go for broke.
Thank you for watching our videos. Be sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day. And don't forget to like and share our channel.